Yes, hello everyone and welcome to all our West Australian football fans to another edition of Around The WAFL, your go-to WAFL podcast in 2024. We're off the back of round 19 and a couple of smashings, thrashings and hits was the theme of the weekend. You can certainly feel it here in the studio and all around the WAFL world, the anticipation of the run home to the finals with only two rounds remaining. Paul Percy with you in the studio to recap all the round 19 WAFL action. Alongside me is the one and only Ethan Roth. And Rothy, huge weekend, round 19 in the books, and some teams really feeling those smashings as they get on the road to September.
Yeah, two rounds to go, Paul. It's really coming together, isn't it? The race for September.
Oh, no doubt. That race is going to be close to the finish, and it's going to be a six-horse race when you think about it, with the final five not being set as of yet, but it could get even closer. We're going to recap all the games in round 19 for you here on Around the WAFL. A couple of big results. And in just a moment, we're going to be chatting to East Perth star Stan Wright, who had a great performance against the West Coast Eagles, and also a reveal of the Player of the Year votes for Round 19 and the leaderboard with two rounds to go. So make sure you stay with us here on your go-to WAFL podcast in 2024. It's Around the WAFL.
Punt from 50. Win. Little too into the game. Win. Too cocky? Meh, almost a win. Risking it all for the glory? Win. It's win-win at the WAFL. Great footy, food and entertainment. Find out more at waffle.com.au.
Yes, win-win big at the WAFL, and a big win it was to East Perth on Saturday over the West Coast Eagles to the tune of 67 points. And one man who played a great hand in that win, of course, is Stan Wright. He wears the number 7 on his back for the black and blue, and he joins us here today on Around the WAFL. Stan, welcome to the show.
Hey, boys. Thanks for having me.
Great to have you on. It was expected that, you know, you'd have a big win against the West Coast Eagles, considering the Eagles with their struggles this season. But was that result, 67 points won, that really boosts your side and gives you a lot of confidence for the next fortnight ahead? Because it's a massive 2 weeks.
Yeah, hopefully, Paul. I don't think we've actually played four quarters of footy for most of the year. So it was good to put in a four-quarter performance against West Coast. It was probably the most pleasing was our connection between our mids and our forwards, which has been lacking the last probably month or two. So it was, yeah, really good to get a good result with it. The forward, we probably should have kicked a few more goals, but we're a bit inaccurate in front of goal, but no, it was a good result nonetheless.
Well, speaking of those forwards, one forward that really impressed me was Jaden Peake up forward. Maybe he doesn't get the recognition compared to some of the other guys, so what can you tell us about him? Because he seems to be really flourishing at the moment.
Yeah, Peake, he works really hard. He's pretty slight in his build, but he works hard. He's pretty hard at the footy. He's really, really quick. And he just does a lot of unrewarded running. So we value that in front of the balls at the footy club. And yeah, it's really good to see him get on the end of the feud this week, also to last week. So it's really pleasing for him.
He's really a star of the future, isn't he, Jaden Peake? In the last couple of weeks, he's been that number one avenue to goal. Is he going to be one that is going to have a lot of responsibility in these next 2 weeks?
I don't think we can put all of our responsibility on Peakey. I think it's more of our tall forwards we need to get a bit more out of, which they did on the weekend, which was great. The small forwards are there to sort of mop up their mess. I think it's with us, it's a good spread and it's a team. So, you know, 1 week, one bloke will pop up and kick 4 or 5 and then the next someone else will. So, but it was great to see a few guys 3 and a couple of guys 2 on the weekend. And, yeah, hopefully have some really good form into the September campaign.
And 30-plus disposals again for yourself in a fine solo effort. How are you feeling, I guess, the back half of the year? You know, it can be a long year. So how's the body holding up with a couple of rounds left in the regular season?
Oh, it's not great, to be honest with you. I'm not getting any younger. 26 is pretty old in the WAFL. Pretty sore. This block is about, I think, 6 games without a bye. So yeah, it's a bit of a battle, but the support staff and all the physios and stuff at the club are really looking after me, and a couple of light weeks so I can have a strongish performance on the weekend.
That your support staff has made a huge difference for the side this season. Of course, the last couple of years there'd been a lot of struggles within the club, but you know, in the last 2 years when they've really contended for the finals of East Perth, they've got, you know, a good core behind you. It's not just, you know, the playing group that can make such a big difference, but it's also the staff behind the scenes that are there on match day as well as on the training nights as well. It plays a really important part.
Yeah, I think the thing is, with Waffle Footy, there's a lot of volunteers involved, so it's fantastic that we've got some of the best in the business in that regard. But I think every Waffle club's pretty lucky with all the great support that they receive, and we're certainly no different. So yeah, we cherish and love all those people that help out, all the volunteers at the footy club. It's a big part of our club, and we want to do this as much for them than for us as players. So they've been excellent.
Building up to the Sharks now, they're obviously a team, you know, hot on form, so really no time better to get them for you guys.
Yeah, well, really see where we are in the scheme of things coming into September, really. It's a good sort of, well, these next 2 weeks are really good, I guess, to see where we're at. So we're excited to play against East Fremantle on our home deck, and it's always a really tight contest, and it's always really physical. It's always good to see how you stack up against the reigning premier. So we're really keen for this weekend.
Star-studded lineups, both of them. We can't wait for that one on Saturday afternoon at Sullivan Logistics Stadium. Good luck against the Sharks on Saturday, Stan. We really appreciate your time here on Around the Waffle. All the best for the rest of the season.
Thanks, boys. Appreciate you having me.
That was Stan Wright from the East Perth Football Club joining us here on Around the Waffle. That is going to be a huge game. East Perth, and he makes a good point. It's where the Royals are well and truly at as contenders, and they're going up against the reigning Premier side who are in rampaging form.
Yeah, it's almost like a pre-final sort of entree, isn't it, for both teams, really. But I think particularly for East Perth, given how much of a streak East Perth have created for themselves in the last month.
No doubt about it. And that's going to be a big time as well for the Sharks as well. Could they meet again in the finals? And could they meet again on this day? Are you getting it? Are you really getting it? Are you getting the grand final filly?
East Fremantle get around him under pressure every time they get possession. Against the trend, the Thunder strike, and there it is.
Feel the excitement and intensity of the WAFL Grand Final, Sunday, September 22nd. Don't miss out. That's right. You getting that grand final feeling, Rothy? It's getting ever closer, September 22nd.
Yeah, hope we all are. It's getting closer.
No doubt about it. Tickets, by the way, go on sale for the general public on August 26th and hospitality options August 24th as well. So keep those dates locked in as well. And no doubt they'll be selling like hotcakes on the biggest day of the year.
Yeah, I know those boxes, you know, they can get pretty popular. It's a full day out. So, I really encourage people to get on them early because... you know, you miss out otherwise.
And also the Waffle Wonderland's back as well for the grand final. How good's that?
Oh, absolutely. It had to be. Yeah. It had to be given, really.
It's a no-brainer and a job well done to the West Australian Football Commission for bringing the concept back for the grand final, proving to be a raging success. And if you get 35 to 40,000 in there, that is going to be something else. Let's go now to the games for round 19. We'll start things off with the morning match on the Saturday at Mineral Resources Park. East Perth taking care of the West Coast Eagles, 17-16, 118-7. 7-9-51. It was academical after quarter time, 5-2. They were never headed. It was a win that East Perth, you know, really were building onto. And I'm not saying that because, you know, West Coast are, you know, an opposition team in the five. But it's one that they needed just to restore the confidence after what had been a bit of a rough patch, if you will, with injuries and a lack of results. But they're going into the next fortnight in a terrific vein of form with this big win over the Eagles.
Yeah, they are. You know, obviously the last two games, you know, really vital for them, but this was just a game they needed to tick off and in style to, you know, boost a bit of percentage as well, more than anything. But yeah, you know, it was probably a game where we all thought they were going to win, but the margin was probably just how much by. And as you said, they took control all game. Their midfield really ran on top and I guess took advantage of the Eagles' struggles, which are still evident.
Well, we mentioned with Stan Wright, 32 disposals. He saw a lot of the football, but it was all with that contested ball that Stanley Wright thrives on. He loves playing that contested game, and it worked wonders for him. Zachary Hill, he got involved tremendously, 10 marks as well. Scott Jones, there was a bit of concern about him after the derby with the injury, but he came back and he really rampaged with 42 hitouts. And Liam Tedesco, usually playing up forward, but he played a bit in the middle with 27 disposals and 9 marks as well, but his goal kicking was a little bit off, had the 3 behinds. In contrast, Jaden Peake, he is something else. I reckon he's going to be one for the future. 3 goals straight from 15 disposals. Watch out for him in the next few weeks. I reckon he could be a key forward that no one could expect.
Yeah, and, you know, it's these guys, the next wave coming through. I mean, last week it was Sturrock and, you know, now Peake. You know, it's these guys who, as I sort of said to Stan, you know, maybe don't get the recognition, but they're going to be the ones driving, you know, the club forward to, you know, how deep they go in September. Obviously, the Stars will do their thing, but yeah, you know, different avenues to go. You're not complaining if you're an East Perth fan.
No doubt about it. They've got plenty of them. The small forwards, they're making up for that lack of a tall forward. Obviously, with Mitch Schofield not playing again this season, Harrison McCready not making as much impact as he would have, only with the 8 disposals on Saturday, but they're getting plenty of small forwards and they're delivering, not just from the likes of Pete Medhat and also Christian Amaduri, who bobbed up and kicked 3 goals inside the 50. Meanwhile, for the West Coast Eagles, Jack Petrocelli, 23 disposals, great leg speed, good run and burn off the midfield. Jermaine Jones, 22, showed good tenacity at 6 inside 50s as well. And Lockie Rawlinson with 2 goals. But, you know, the struggles of continuity are still there for that Eagles side. You know, what 22 is there on the field? What identity have they got on the field? Okay, it's good that they're coming back next year, but what sort of identity are they building for the future? And we see this performance like this, only 7 goals for the day. There's more questions than answers what we got from West Coast.
Yeah, well, with the AFL team winning again on the weekend, you know, you'd expect a similar sort of lineup. So, you know, hopefully, as we'll touch, I guess, more on Thursday for the game against Claremont, you know, they can have a bit more continuity at WAFL level. But, yeah, as you said, Jack Petrocelli probably has to take a bit more responsibility in the at WAFL level in the midfield, kick the goal, compared to, you know, in the AFL when he's more of a forward. Mm. Even Jermaine Jones as well, having, you know, stints in there of half-back. But, yeah, the Eagles, a couple games to go for them. You know, they'd love to be able to pinch another win, but yeah, I think we can't be too critical on them as well. You know, they've had a much better season than a couple of years gone past. Yeah, yes, they're still, you know, getting beaten more often than not and convincingly, but you know, this group's going to take time. I think, you know, it's not going to be an overnight thing.
No, it's not the end of the world for the West Coast Eagles. It's not going to happen just like that. You know, all they need is just a couple more good players that can really step it up, you know, in WAFL level for the Eagles and that continuity. And those younger players, it has to be said as well, they've got a good dynamic under Kyle Horsley, of course, a young coach coming up through the ranks, having played at Subiaco, a triple premiership player. But still a lot that's needed for the West Coast Eagles. Of course, that win for East Perth will do wonders. They can still finish on top of the ladder with 2 rounds to go. They're going to have Brayshaw potentially come back for the game against East Fremantle this weekend, which is a massive, massive boost. And of course, they'll go into the next fortnight with a heap of confidence. Can they win their last 2 games?
Yeah, well, that's the question, isn't it? That they'll certainly be thinking so after the weekend. So, yeah, have to wait and see on that front. But East Perth, they'll be backing themselves in. And, you know, the minor premier is not a title that, you know, often comes around. I guess no. East Perth, they've you know, not finished top of the ladder, I think, maybe since 2014. It's been a decade. So, yes, an opportunity does beckon. And I guess for their sake, their destiny is really in their own hands.
No doubt about it. 2 rounds to go. East Perth back on track, truly, with a 67-point win over the West Coast Eagles on Saturday. Now we go to game 2 of round 19. It was Subiaco taking on Perth at Sullivan Logistics Stadium. It looked tight for 3 quarters, but then what about the Lions turning on the firepower in the last quarter? 8 goals to nil to win by 44 points over the Demons, an effort that certainly pleased Lions coach Bo Wardman. That finish in that last quarter where the Lions really romped away from the Demons, especially off the boot of Ryan Borchette, who kicked 3 critical goals. What form has he been on in the forward line?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah, we know what he's been able to do over a numerous amount of years, but he's really stepped up in this back half of the year. He might pull a few best and fairest votes to come home with a wet sail in their count. Mm. But yeah, Subiaco, scoreboard probably doesn't really reflect the game. You know,
no.
It was a 50-point-plus turnaround because Perth were leading in the early stages of the game. But
well, it was an 11-goal-to-1 second half in total. I mean, when you look at how Subiaco turned the game around.
Yeah, Subiaco, you know, they've really, you know, some positives to take into 2025, I feel like. you know, the way you finish the year can really have an impact on your off season. And I think that's the way they're heading, and it's a big tick for Bo Waterman, his development side of things as well. You know, showing why he has been signed to a 2-year deal.
What does that do for Perth, however? Because that's another wasted opportunity to win. And they've been having these tendencies to fade out in the second half. They've been getting great starts against quality opposition like Claremont, South Fremantle, West Perth and East Fremantle. But half of that time, they haven't been able to get on with it in the second half. That wouldn't please Peter German in the slightest. And it wouldn't please the players in the slightest as well, because it's a four-quarter game, not a two-quarter game.
Yeah, absolutely. And That's it, you know. That's been sort of the story of their year to a degree. Perth, you know, I don't think their ability to find the footy has been an issue. You know, Constable in there near on 40 disposals, Byrne 32 disposals. But, yeah, it's just a little bit of help beneath them. And, you know, I feel like they recruited really well over the off-season, and, you know, no one sort of maybe, you know, expected that to happen straight away. But, you know, they had nearly a year together now, so yes, Constable's just only come back from injury, but should they need to recruit again? I mean, it's something they're going to have to look at.
Only time will tell. They've still got another two games to go, that being against South Fremantle and Swan Districts. Just looking at some of the numbers, we highlighted Subiaco a lot off the air when we were getting set for the show, but Liam Hickmont, he played such a pivotal role, 30 disposals and 7 marks. Up forward, we mentioned Borchette and Sokol. I was speaking with Taj Schofield on radio on Monday morning, and he was highlighting the continuity of that forward line. It just lacked that function, that primal function for much of the season, with Sokol being injured and out of form, Mayo being out of form, and Borchette playing majority of the first half of the season in the back line to everyone's surprise. But now they've got him back up forward, and Sokol's now getting back into form, 6 goals between them. That really is a highlight for the Lions and something they'll look forward to in 2025.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can't rely on Ben Sokol forever. So you exactly. need to be able to find, you know, gems, diamonds in the rough beneath that. And one they found is Malachi Champion. Mm. You know, he's obviously been touted for some time to be, you know, a player who will, you know, probably not be there next year, let's face it. You know,
he'll probably get drafted. Yeah. I mean, top pick, I reckon. He's got what it takes.
Yeah, a couple games of league and then he'll go back to the Colts. But they'll keep him for as long as they can in the league. Don't worry about that, because I'm not sure I've seen a player, you know, have the impact of limited amount of touches that he can have. Just gets the ball, split second, and he'll make you pay.
Well, he only had 11 touches, but the impact that he had in every single one of them, as you said, was absolutely immense. He also got two goals as well, further two goals to really boost his tally and his chances for a draft as well, for a draft pick. He's absolutely sensational, Malachi Champion. His run in that half-forward line, his acceleration when he's got the ball on his hand, really electrifies the crowd. From a Perth perspective, I think that the number that highlighted this the most, even though the numbers don't tell the full story, Blake Schlensock, very impressive again in the ruck. 43 hitouts, and he had 15 touches. His follow-up work starting to improve, especially, you know, he was originally listed as a cover for Josh Edwards, you know, when he broke his ribs a few weeks ago. But when he was shifted into the ruck, that number one ruckman, he has really lived up to the task. 43 hitouts, 15 disposals, and a couple of inside 50s. I've been very impressed with the former Bulldog.
Yeah, well, while we don't, you know, wish injuries on anyone, I think to a degree, you know, potentially Edwards going out has been sort of a gain for Schlensock. I still think Perth probably wouldn't ideally have him as their number one ruck. They want him behind the ball, even forward the ball, you know, a versatile swing man. But yeah, the job that he's been able to do to cover in the meantime has probably exceeded their own expectations.
Certainly has. Perth, they've got a gem in Blake Schlensock in the ruck, but it was Subiaco that provided all of it in the second half. 44-point winners over Perth, and another big sign that they're on the way back up in 2025. Third game of round 19, Claremont, they turned it on from go to woe against West Perth, who again suffered the wobbles in front of goal. 11-17-83 to 6-17-53, a margin of 30 points. Claremont now into the five, and it's looking less likely that they'll drop back down because they've got a bit of an easy run. Of course, they've got to West Coast and then Subiaco to finish off. But on this game, they really needed a big win just to boost their percentage and their confidence a little bit more against the West Perth side. It was largely disappointing, and there were two players that really provided all the sizzle in that. Oliver Eastland in the ruck, again, and Mungaroo Frederick, who is in terrific form in the last month.
Yeah, his leg speed. Yeah, it's without question, isn't it? The way he can hit the scoreboard off half-back is particularly, but yeah, also their Sandover medalist as well.
Bally Rogers, yeah.
Took the game by the scruff of the neck. Bolton and Rogers, and a couple of celebrations to go with it. Oh. You know, they're not shy of the passion still with the Claremont at this later stage of the year. They know that fifth spot, you know, is, let's face it, is likely to be theirs. Obviously, destiny is still in their own hands, and, you know, we don't want to say anything's guaranteed, but the way they're playing, you know, it was, you know, coming into it, a win that they would have expected. 30 points in the end over, you know, a struggling West Perth outfit. But yeah, Claremont, you know, all signs are leading towards September.
Absolutely. And I like the fact that they're playing with that extra passion. Those celebrations really show that they are hungry for that final spot, considering that they were 0-3 at the beginning of the season. Who would have thought they'd be 0-3? But look what they have done in the second half of the season. They have turned things around magnificently. And I think it's reinforced the message that anyone in the five can win the premiership, not just the top three. That trend can be bucked this year. And I think Claremont is showing that they can contend as well, even though, you know, this was a win against the side in 10th place now. You know, it's a West Perth side that have been competitive for the most part, but Claremont, they just ramped it up from that first quarter and just never looked likely to head on the back foot. Callan England also, he had another good outing with 27 disposals. Anthony Davis from the halfback line with 23. He even shifted down forward for a goal as well. And also, only two players kicked multiple goals. Keep in mind, Bolton and Rogers were the only ones, and there was a good scoring spread. So the depth when going inside 50 and heading into goal is there for the Tigers, and it's coming good at the right time.
Goal kicking midfielders, you're never going to complain with that. And an interesting point you made, you know, they were 0-3, and that sort of says that while you obviously want to start the, you know, the year in the best fashion possible, and, you know, history will say if you lose 0-3, a lot of teams won't make finals. I think it also says that premierships aren't won in March.
No, that's
they're not
right.
Won in April. They're not won in, they're actually won in September.
That's right.
Believe it or not. It might sound like the most obvious thing ever.
But it's true.
But it's true. You know, you need to be playing your best footy towards the back end of the year.
That's
and
right.
As it stands, Claremont are on that trajectory.
Absolutely. I mean, looking at their past record, they've only lost one or two games since the halfway mark of the season. They're the best form team in the second half at the moment. Some, I would say, even better than East Fremantle and even better than East Perth as well. Look at the way Claremont have rampaged along in the second half of the season. They deserve to be in that five if they remain there in the next 2 weeks, especially when you've got your experienced players and your younger talent as well firing at the right time, especially Frederick. Lewis Becerra got some ball down back, also Mitch Barron as well, and Kieran Gowdy, who were bobbed up for a goal as well. Meanwhile, West Perth, it just continues to get worse. Worse and worse and worse for West Perth, even though, you know, you see your usual suspects there flooding the stat sheet as well. They didn't do much of an impact, and especially their forwards, Corey Rundle and Tyler Keitel, only 7 behinds between them. It was a horror show.
Yeah, I think the most worrying thing is their goal kicking. It feels like we're sitting here week after week, broken record. I know, you know, Claremont kicked themselves out of it a little bit as well, you know, kicking 6 more behinds than goals themselves. But 6-17, I mean, I don't think that's really acceptable.
No, it isn't.
At any level of footy. But yeah, West Perth, you know, a couple games for them, and yeah, they're such a proud club, but I think potentially even, you know, I don't want to say that they want the year to be over. You know, you always get yourself up for a waffle game of footy no matter what the occasion is. But yeah, interesting to see how much more youth they blood in the coming game.
West Perth staring down their first wooden spoon since 1992, and back in the day they had the likes of Paul Mifka in the side as well, and Jeff Geeshan was about to take over as coach at that time. But Riley Sprigg in the ruck, he was well beaten by Eastland on the day. Shane Nelson had 28. Connell Lynch had his most impactful performance in some time. He had 9 marks to go with his 26 disposals, but not a lot went right for West Perth on that. They just couldn't, you know, kick accurately. That was the thing. They had 4 less inside 50s, and their disposals per goal, this was alarming. It took 57 disposals per goal in contrast to Claremont's 32. You know, that's how alarming that performance was from a West Perth point of view.
I wonder, you know, I feel like maybe some people thought this could have been coming, you know, with the veterans only getting older and, you know, the youth, you know, coming through. But to this degree, I wonder, you know, if they thought it was going to be this bad, this diabolical, you know, to finish last on the ladder. You know, there's missing finals, but then in this fashion, it's interesting to see, you know, how out of the question this could have been for their sake.
Absolutely. Of course, Claremont, however, they are right back into the five, and they deserve to be, according to many, 30-point winners over West Perth at Revo Fitness Stadium. Then we go to match number 4, and the result could prove costly for South Fremantle. They went down to Peel Thunder by 10 points, 9-7-61 to 10-11-71. Peel back on top of the ladder, as they deserve to be. They have been in rollicking form throughout the season so far. It was a late challenge by the Bulldogs. They kept right at it. While they weren't beaten badly, they remained in touch, but they just couldn't get even closer to Peel Thunder. I mean, they led at one stage. They kicked the first 2 goals of the game, but Peel Thunder got that momentum back and stayed in front for much of the afternoon.
It just felt like every time, you know, Southfield were coming back, Peel just knew what to do and were just like holding them off, almost teasing them in a way with a 10-point win in the end. So, yeah, Peel's forward line really, you know, sparked, and Taj Wyberg three goals for him, you know, really provided a lot of electricity as a small forward, you know, has played a lot of backline, but yeah, to kick three goals as he did.
Yeah, three goals straight. Very impressive for Taj White. But several players bobbed up with multiple goals as well. Cooper Simpson and also Nathan Wilson as well. But they got great supply from their midfield, as they always have done. Liam Reedy, a monstrous 54 hitouts. He dominated once again. Could be getting some Sandover votes come September. Will Brody, 43 disposals. Neil Erasmus, 35. James Aish, 29. Impressive performance from him. And Michael Selwood down back, again creating an impact in the back. Eight marks to go with his 20 disposals. They just continue to fire on all cylinders, Peel Thunder. They know they want that premiership after losing last year's grand final. They're proving why they're a hungry side.
Yeah, you know, they want to go a step further, don't they? And there's so many reasons for that, to play for it. And yeah, you mentioned Liam Reedy. I know there's been a little bit of uproar about why he wasn't in the Fremantle team, you know,
I'd love to know.
Over Tabiner.
I honestly would love to know, why the hell is Liam Reedy not in that Docker side?
Yeah, I mean, if there was one question I could ask Justin Longmuir, I'd seriously say, what else does Reedy need to do?
Exactly.
And, you know, I'd love to know the answer. But yeah, the Bulldogs, it could be a really costly loss for them, falling out. But, you know, yeah, while a loss is a loss, I feel like a 10-point loss to Peel Thunder, you know, I don't want to look at it as from a surface level of just the margin, but, you know, I feel like it's still, there would be still steps in the right direction from their point of view, but, you know, I know a lot of people don't want to hear that heading towards finals.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, all they want is those results. They want those big wins to get into the five. That's the main objective in the last month of the season. But there were some big sparks. Edward Graham, he bobbed up to kick 3 goals, 2. A good stint up forward for him. Aaron Drage down back. He had 18 disposals and 6 very good intercept marks. Chad Pearson had the 20 disposals. Glenn Byron and Tom Bletchenden had 26 disposals each. They all got a lot of ball and got some good run and carry in the midfield. Glenn Byron also had 9 tackles as well. Equal inside 50s, 38 apiece, but it was how effective Peel Thunder were going inside 50 in contrast to South Fremantle at such a critical stage as well. This loss for South Fremantle obviously does more harm than good, but I reckon it's going to steer the resolve in the Bulldogs, because that's 2 losses in a row now at Fremantle Oval, and they know that they can do a whole lot better than that.
Hopefully that, yeah, gives them the motivation if they don't have enough already. But one player, yeah, I really like Ed Graham. I think 3 goals, 2, you know, a little bit inaccurate, but still to kick 3 on the day. I think he's a player, you know, because the Strong brothers, you know, they're only getting older. You know, I think Ed Graham is a real player for the future. They can solidify himself as, you know, the centre-half forward, the full forward of this team for you know, a decade if he wants to do that. I feel like he's a big size, you know, a big presence, can take a good mark and, you know, maybe flies under the radar a little bit.
Absolutely. Edward Graham could be someone for the future, I reckon, up forward, because that's another thing they're lacking, is that prime tall forward. They need someone there. And Edward, he's only like 20 years old. 20, he's only 20 years old, and yeah, he's quite a tall forward. And I reckon that could be someone that Todd Curley would look at for the future if South Fremantle don't make the five.
I think you just got to stick with him, though, as
absolutely.
Well. You got to keep playing him. So I think that's continuities piece as much as possible.
And that's something they need in the next 2 weeks, South Fremantle. But Peel Thunder, they've got continuity down to a T. Winners by 10 points over South Fremantle and back on top of the ladder. And then we go to the final game at Pentanet Stadium in neutral ground. It was. Many expected this one to be an absolute shootout between East Fremantle and Swan Districts, but it was East Fremantle that shot Swan Districts right out of it from the first half. 11 goals to 4 in the first half, and they got right on with the business, did East Fremantle. A 36-point win over Swan Districts, and they remain in the fight for the double chance. It was a performance they needed, and no matter where they play their home games, they just continue to get it done.
Yeah, I mean, I saw, obviously, you were on the call for it, but just watching the game, I thought, like, yes, they won the game, but I feel like it was a business as usual. I just saw the body language, and I was like, yes, it's a good win. But I think, yeah, bigger things coming for East Freo. I think it was just the tick they needed, and they're not over sort of celebrating. But, yeah, right from the outset, they really dominated, and it was probably the game of the round that we sort of earmarked, you know, just with the hot form that Swan Districts have been on. But that streak does come to an end for them, and probably a bigger margin than they would have thought.
Yeah, that margin I don't think will flatter them a lot. You know, 36 at one stage, it was getting close to 50 as well, because East Fremantle were just ruthless around the football. Their pressure was excellent. Their forward pressure as well, not only their forward pressure, but but their pressure around the football with their tackling and their hard contested footy, which has been a big hallmark for them over the last month as well. When you go back to a couple of big wins over Perth, the People's Derby over South Fremantle, and of course this one over Swan Districts. And when you have Milan Murdoch in form, Cam Murdley going forward again and kicking two goals, Blaine Bokers playing a bit down back as well, and Kyle Baskerville really shutting down those Swans key midfielders with some good close checking in midfield, and also Cody Leggett coming back after missing the Derby and kicking four goals. That forms a good nucleus to a great side that is coming into good form after being a little bit wobbly midway through the season.
Yeah, absolutely. The back-to-back dream is still very much alive from their point of view. And we talk about Swan District streak, but East Fremantle, I think it's worth noting their streak that they've created as
well.
Five
wins in a row now. Remember, they had a big streak of their own. They won 11 in a row to win the premiership. Are they forming another one as they head for back-to-back maybe? Who knows? A player I thought who was really magnificent again was Lockie Blackiston in the ruck, another 41 hitouts. He took Nathan Blakely to the cleaners on Saturday afternoon. And, you know, it's only 10th or 11th game that he's played, and he's dominating in the ruck against higher quality opposition, more experienced opposition. I mean, it's a testament to what he has done. He's waited for some time in reserves before he got his big chance, and he's taken it with two hands.
Yeah, blessing in disguise after Bryn Teagle left, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, they would have only dreamt of a situation like this after losing Teagle. So, yeah, it's phenomenal, really, given, you know, the context of, you know, only under 10 games of footy, really.
Absolutely. From a Swan Districts point of view, I looked at their body language, a couple of players on the bench as well. They had their heads down in the third quarter. Even though they were able to get some goals, four goals in the third quarter, only one in the last, I could see a couple of their heads down knowing that this was a game that they're not going to come back from because of how ruthless the Sharks were. That's something that you don't need at this stage in the season when you're getting close the finals, and when you still have a chance to go top spot in the ladder. It was a chance that they blew because of a lack of effort in that first half, honestly. I mean, they just had no effort to counter the likes of Erdley, Murdoch, Jupp, Maguire, Lennon Marlin down back as well. They just had no answer. That's not a performance that would be accepting by Swan District's fans and the coach, Andrew Prun.
Yeah, caught off guard to say the least. And I think going back a few weeks when we had Prun on the show, you know, that's what he was talking about. We're not getting ahead of ourselves. He knows that, you know, while, you know, ideally you don't want to lose games, it's probably a streak. There is some chance it's going to come to an end. Obviously, they didn't.
But were they due a loss? They always say, you know, you're due a loss. I reckon this one, even though it wasn't an acceptable performance to some, I reckon that'll spur them on for the next 2 weeks because they've got Peel Thunder next, and then they've got Perth at home, and always the last game of the season is the hardest for a lot of teams.
Yeah, it's a funny thing to say, but I don't think it is the worst thing for them. You never want to lose a game of footy, but sometimes it can be the best thing. Just a reality check. Okay, just take a deep breath. Are we getting ahead of ourselves? It's better to lose a game now than in finals. And as long as you're not losing a game and it's costing you, you know, to finish as high as possible on the ladder, or your confidence or your continuity, then I don't think it's the end of the world. And yes, we mentioned that, you know, that deficit, but I think Luke Kelly was a player that really got them back into the game.
Oh, he was brilliant.
I think they've found one there to stick with for the future. You know, left footer hits the scoreboard, which maybe was a little bit of a knock on him, you know, in his draft year last year when he played in the 18s, maybe that ability to hit the scoreboard, which he's really out of this year in spades.
Absolutely. Three goals straight for Luke Kelly, and all came at such a critical period when the Swans just looked like we thought at the time were starting to fight their way back into the game. And when he got supply from Aiden Clark, who had 28, Josh Sepro, who had 22, and Jesse Turner also having 28, but it came sort of a little bit too late. They were playing catch-up in that third quarter, especially against an East Fremantle side that are on the rampage, Rothy. Five wins in a row. They are looking the goods for September. They leap back into contention for the double chance, a 34-point win over Swan Districts to cap off round 19.
Introducing the WAFL Merch Shop, your ultimate destination for all things WAFL. From jerseys to scarves to caps, show your support for the WAFL in style. Grab exclusive merchandise now and gear up to cheer louder than ever before. Visit shop.wafl.com.au today and let your passion shine.
How good is that merch store, Rothy? Shop.wafl.com.au. There's going to be a lot of people representing the WAFL with great merch with two rounds to go. I saw a few of the beanies in the crowd at Pentanet Stadium. They are selling quite well.
Yeah, you almost look out of place if you don't have merch.
Absolutely. No doubt, whether it be waffle merch or the club merch as well that we see out there on the ground as well. Let's go to the ladder with two rounds remaining. Peel Thunder and East Perth again tied on top of the ladder, but it's Peel holding down first on percentage. Then comes the Royals. Swan Nine districts remain in third, but their loss to East Fremantle opens things up. Hell, even East Fremantle could take top spot with two rounds to go. Even Claremont, who are in fifth on 36, could still get the double chance. So the final five almost set, but the order, there is no way that the order of the final five is decided. South Fremantle just outside at 2 points behind. Then comes Subiaco, Perth, West Coast and West Perth. But as I said, Rothy, that five, there's no way that order is getting resolved this coming weekend.
Yeah, the race is wide open, isn't it? And I think, you know, players and coaches might say, oh, you know, just the cliche, focus 1 week at a time. I bet you they're looking at all the calculations as much as we are. You know, what do we need to do to win? How high can we finish? What will this result do if we don't win? All these sort of combinations, I reckon they're just on top of it as we are.
It's going to be very tough to determine who finishes where come round 21. Let's go now to the votes for the player of the year. One vote from Claremont, Jai Bolton. That was one of his better games. I mean, many talk about, you know, his efficiency and whatnot whenever he gets the ball, but he was on a roll, Jai Bolton, against West Perth on Saturday. So he gets one vote. Two votes go to Angus Schumacher of West Perth. He, like Bolton, very impactful. East Perth, rather. Angus Schumacher from East Perth, he was sensational. Like Bolton, he was very impactful in midfield when his team needed it the most, because, you know, after a bit of a wobbly stretch, Angus Schumacher was a bit out of form. He finally was able to get back into that groove. So from East Perth, Angus Schumacher gets the two votes. Three votes go to Kyle Baskerville. I reckon he played a good shutdown role on Swans' prime contested ball winners. I mean, 11 tackles really tell how important his role was against Swan Districts on Saturday. Four votes, Liam Hickmott of Subiaco. He again was sensational, 30 disposals, coming into form at the right time, and especially now looking ahead to 2025, Liam Hickmott again is going to be a key. But the five votes for the Around the Waffle Top Gun Around 19 goes to the rampaging bull from Peel Thunder in the ruck, Liam Reedy, 54 hitouts, and he provided a real key for Peel Thunder's midfield.
Yeah, a lot of love for the rucks. You have to recognise them, don't you? And just a quick word on all of them. Liam Hickmott, I mean, I think he could potentially be a future captain of Subiaco. You know, Kyle Baskerville, as you said, just does it offensively and defensively. He's really reliable in there on those two fronts. Angus Schumacher, yeah, just using that big body to his advantage as usual. He's just the player they can call upon when they need him the most as well. And Jai Bolton, I mean, he's been the best player in the Waffle for over a decade. And so celebrations to match. A couple. I don't know who he was giving to. Maybe some friends or fans.
Showing the love to the fans. You know, it gets them involved.
That deep pocket on the left hand side of screen in the right hand pocket. He had some fans over there.
Can we rename it Bolton's pocket? Can we start a petition to rename it Bolton's pocket, like what Eddie Betts did in the AFL, the Adelaide Oval, Eddie's pocket?
Yeah. Well, I don't know if he'll be campaigning for that himself, but I mean, we can maybe try our best.
Maybe it'll be fantastic. Bolton's pocket. Bolton going for goal from his own pocket. That'll be absolutely magnificent. But where does that leave the leaderboard? Well, it's unchanged after round 19. 61 players have polled at the present time, but in the top 10, unchanged. Still Mitch Crowden on 15, Oliver Eastland on 14, Jesse Turner on 12, Hayden Schloyth and Jonathan Marsh tying for 4th on 10, Will Brody and Lockie Blackiston each on 9, and then rounding out the top 10 on 8 votes, Lee Coleman, Nathan Wilson and Bryn Teagle. Very tight there at the top, unchanged after this round. Still a lot can happen with two rounds remaining.
I said it the other week, I think 20 votes you'll take it home.
20 votes.
Get to that 20 vote buffer.
Well, if anyone can get to it, it's going to be very, very tough, no doubt about it. It's going to be harder to pick than a broken nose. That does it for today's edition of Around the Waffle. If you missed out on our live broadcast, don't fret. You can check it out on your podcast provider and on YouTube as well, anytime, any place, anywhere. You can also check us out on your socials as well, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for all the best social content on Around the Waffle. Rothy, great job from you as always. I'll see you on Thursday. It's a massive episode.
It is awesome, Paul. See you then.
No doubt about it. We'll see you, listeners and viewers, as well for Thursday's episode. We're going to look ahead to a massive round 20, another five games where the final five could be set. And we're also having a chat to South Fremantle's Tom Bletchenden, so make sure you stay tuned for that, and some historic news surrounding the Perth Football Club and their women's program for 2025. We look forward to your company on Thursday for another big edition of Around the Waffle.